for inviting me.
Yeah, it's on.
I thought, in honor of the organization, I would adjust one of my talks to sort of consider not whether pluralism is a good thing, but whether pluralism can succeed, and whether it's succeeded in the past relative to the neoclassical orthodoxy. Okay. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to go through any of that earlier stuff that he mentioned. That's not the point of today. The point of today, instead, is to question what sorts of criticisms of the orthodoxy actually go nowhere, and then what sort of criticisms of the orthodoxy might have a prayer of turning into something truly different as an alternative. Okay. Now, I come at this as a historian, but don't worry, I'm not going to do a lot of history in here, although I will at one point suggest that this has a long history to it, the tradition that I'm going to suggest, but that long history is itself not the point either. I don't think pluralism means going back to a past orthodoxy. So, for example, some of you may have heard a recent talk on neo-Ricardianism and so forth. I honestly think that, however interesting that is, or Marxism for that case, that going back is not a live option. All right? But then we need to talk about why and under what circumstances certain things could be a live option for a different sort of economics. Now, one more thing I should warn you about, too, before I get started. I know a lot of students get into economics, especially after the crisis, right, because of macroeconomics, and that they think, in a sense, the thing that really matters is macroeconomics. They may be unhappy with certain aspects of modern macroeconomics, and they feel that there are other macroeconomics out there. Now, I'm not denying any of that, but I think that the problem with that is that the core of the defense of the orthodoxy is not in the macro, which is in a mess, by the way. Anyone who knows anything about the history knows that. It's in the microeconomics. That's where the core of the defense really lies. And so, I'm suggesting right at the outset, the only way there's going to be a pluralism is if there were a serious challenger to the microeconomics. And I don't think many people either study that or manage to think about that enough. So that, in a sense, is one of the theme songs of today's talk. All right, I'm clicking. It's not going forward. Do I have to go down here and do this? Oh, okay, fine. Whoops. Yeah, right. Take me back. Ah, okay, good. All right. Then every time I touch it, it does that. Right. Okay. Now, the way I phrased the title was to counterpose two possibilities. Okay. And I'm doing that, obviously, for simplicity's sake. But still, I mean, let's entertain that for a moment. I think that many people think that economics is really about the nature of humanity, that the nature of human beings is central to its justification in various ways, okay? And certainly in the neoclassical tradition, there has been a tendency to argue that way, okay? Now, I don't have a lot of time to do this. This is a talk in and of itself. Why should we ever believe that economists should specialize in human nature? Just want to throw that out there. Why should we ever believe that? Okay. I'm giving you a number of arguments that should at least suggest that maybe we should question that. One is that economists have never seriously made close intellectual contact with the history of psychology. Never. I will stand behind that statement. Okay? They aren't serious about human psychology if serious means let's get some psychologists over here and hash out what human beings are really like. you might come back to me and say, oh, no, what about behavioral? Just wait. Okay? They have never historically been interested in real human psychology. Why? Well, you heard a little bit of it. I mean, this is the only mention I'm going to make of my earlier work. In More Heat Than Light, I show you where neoclassicism came from. It didn't come from anybody discovering utility. Nothing was discovered. No, I'm being serious as a historian. There was nothing to discover. Instead, what happened was a number of individuals in different countries, and you all know their names, right? Jevons, Walras, Pareto, so forth and so on. All, if you read what they said, did the same thing. What did they do? They imitated classical physics of their time. And that model that we still have today is, at its birth, classical energy physics of the mid to later 19th century. Now, the reason they believed this was a good idea and why they talked about mind and so forth was because, if you know anything about the history of science, see, this is where it gets difficult. You need to know a lot more than economics to understand this. If you know anything about the history of science, there really was a school called energetics at the time that believed that the way to understand the mind was to kind of reduce mental principles to movements of energy and so forth. You see, so it's not crazy. I want you to understand that this was a belief at the time shared by other people, so it's not so unusual that they would do it. What's unusual is that they turned it into a theory of price, which is, of course, not what anyone else was doing. Okay, so that's the extra part. But remember, even if that was slightly plausible in the 1870s to the 1890s, it stopped being plausible from the 1890s onwards. In other words, the energetics approach to the mind fell into disuse. People stopped believing it. But the economists didn't stop. All right? Third, there have been these kind of waves of interest in some kind of behavioralism and linking it to some kind of neoclassical theory over time. Okay, I don't have time to go into it. I concede there have been these waves. But all these waves have done is they've encouraged basically pointless and endless kibitzing by outsiders saying, as I'm sure you felt in your own classes sometime, people don't really act like that. If you felt that, there's nothing new. You're not original. People have felt that during these waves of behavioralism throughout the history from the 1880s onwards. Nothing ever changes. See, that's an argument that psychology doesn't matter, isn't it? That waves and waves of people keep insisting that no, people don't behave that way for whatever their reasons, and nothing changes. So that doesn't matter either. And see, I'm actually going to suggest that later on as I come on. This whole idea that you could reform economics by somehow arguing with them about the nature of human beings is a waste of time. Because it's not about that. Someone might say it's about that, but it's not. Historically, we can point. It's not about that. All right. Now, moreover, many people also feel, well, I would like a more humanistic economics. I would like an economics that's more about humanity and so forth. That's also a common theme throughout the history. And in fact, I actually concede to the Austrians, the Austrian school, that there, whenever anyone talks about a humanism with regard to neoclassical theory, it's fake. It's not a real humanism. Because it's not about human beings. See, again, I'm not the first to say this. It's a common complaint. All right. So, and I could go on and on about this, but I got even more important things to get to. So here's the bottom line of this, that I'm not sure why anybody thinks economics is about humans anymore. Because none of the evidence supports that, historical evidence. All right. And I have never heard a good argument that the market is reducible to human nature. Why would that be so? Okay. But of course, that's one way that you're sold, at least as an undergraduate, the importance of neoclassical economics. All right, I'm going to continually do this all the time. Come on. Okay. Okay, you might think that, oh, who is this guy just spouting off like this? Why can he say these things? These things have been said by people who are, I consider, are much more brilliant than I am. Take Alan Kerman. How many people in the room have heard of Alan Kerman? Oh, God. Wake up, kids. There are important writers out there. Alan, who's still alive, is one of them. Okay. Alan has a lovely article in a book that I edited called Demand Theory, A Journey Down the Wrong Road. All right. In it, he suggests, and this is a quote from Alan, the most important questions that disappeared in the neoclassical scene was who set the prices? And in particular, this situation doesn't get better, it gets worse over time. Every once in a while, I'm going to make reference to some technical result. Don't worry. It's just so that you would know, if you're curious, where to look. What I mean is, after the 70s and the Sonnenschein-Mantel-DeBrew theorems, there is no argument, no logical argument in Walrasian general equilibrium about how prices are set, because there is no relationship between excess demand and any regular kind of dynamics. So the question of who sets the prices does not get better, it gets worse. This is Alan talking, so you don't have to believe me. As he says, another quote, one cannot talk about equilibrium prices independently of market organization. Aha. This is the beginning of my theme for today. That is the weakness. The weakness is all of these neoclassicals want to talk about equilibrium prices, and I don't hold that against them. They imitated physics, please. It's that they want to do that independently of the way markets are organized. That's the mistake. Demand in this view is not defined in any simple and general way. Should I say that again? Demand is not defined in any simple and general way, but depends upon the institutional framework in which it is expressed. Now, this is someone who spent his life, or at least the early part of his life, in the Walrasian tradition. Okay? I think a truly pluralistic economics has to take those hints to heart. All right? Back to me. This fascination with reducing all law governance to individuals is purely ideological. It has no intellectual content. Now, somebody earlier asked me about agent-based models, you know, which is a question one often gets when one makes these complaints. Okay, so maybe Walrasian general equilibrium not so hot. But at least we have these people who are doing these agent-based models. And by the way, they're friends of mine. I want to be clear about this. Doyne Farmer, Duncan Foley, Duncan especially, Lee Tesfatsian, Rajiv Sethi, they all see the problem, and they think that this problem, remember, which was about talking about market organization as opposed to individuals, is solved by modeling many different supposed individuals interacting in a kind of a simulation, for those of you who know anything about agent-based. What I want to point out is that their way of dealing with the problem is insufficient. All right. It's insufficient because, first, all the built-in dynamics of the models depend upon simple bilateral personal rules. See, it's always still about the people and the rules between them, or else reducing agency to simplistic if-then behaviors. Because remember, you know, we're not really modeling robots. I mean, it's really kind of simplified because there are many different ones of them. So, you know, really, they're just little bits of code. Okay. Even the agent-based model people are way too fascinated by agency over institutional structure. You see, they want to break free, and they can't from this trap. That they think they're going to load all the difference, the pluralism, onto agency to make a different economics. Now, diversity, what does diversity mean for them? It means very simplistic types of agents. Noise traders, I don't know if you guys ever heard of this, noise traders. I'm going to come back to them. Noise traders are very interesting. They're basically little bits of code that are basically random number generators. Limited memory processing. And then maybe there's a few sophisticated players in these models, but of course sophisticated players have to have a model of the world. And what model do they use? Some form of the neoclassical model. You see, you don't escape this way. You don't really end up doing anything different. Now that's a little sad, right? I mean, we're looking for true difference. These people are claiming they have true difference, and you know, when you understand how the models work, it's not really there. Okay, now, I'm just gonna say something here, and it's gonna offend people, but you know, we gotta get it out of the way. And I can't justify it because it's a different book. It's a new book that's coming out from Oxford next year called The Knowledge That We Have Lost in Information, which is a history of the way in which the orthodoxy treats information in economics, okay? In that book, I make the following argument. All of this nostalgia for humanism is pointless because in the 21st century, in other words, in your lifetimes, the orthodoxy is moving in an anti-humanist direction anyway. The orthodoxy is becoming more and more anti-humanist. What do I mean by that? See, now this is the grand generalization, which would need tons of illustration to make you believe it. Basically, the whole profession has become more neoliberal. And by the way, that is not a left swear word. That is a very specific subset of theories of society, based in the Mont Pelerin Society around Hayek, Buchanan, a number of other people, all right? And basically, one of the central doctrines that holds them together is that the market is a super information processor that is smarter than any human being. I mean, you don't understand neoliberalism if you don't understand that, because that's where most of their other doctrines come from, okay? I would say that neoclassicism didn't start that way. Of course it didn't. But over time, neoclassicism has become more and more neoliberal. So it, too, partakes of this vision of the market as if it were smarter than any human being. Think of efficient markets hypothesis. I mean, we could just go down the list. There's like 8 million things that are like this, okay? Let me just put it this way. If the market is smarter than everybody, then what difference does it make what you think? And I am not joking. See, humanism is irrelevant. If you really believe this, so the orthodoxy is becoming more hostile to humanism as well. And that, and if you don't like that, let's take the behavioral nudge folks, you know, Thaler and what's his name, the other guy, the nudge guy, okay? This whole idea that what you can do is you can sort of use behavioral economics to figure out the ways in which people diverge from neoclassicism and then nudge them back towards it. Right? That's kind of how it works. If that's true,
what difference does it make what you think? The behavioral nudge literature is anti-humanist too. See, it's everywhere. I'm going to argue shortly this is cultural. This isn't because a few economists think this way, okay? And then we could also do market design. Market design, very fascinating subset of modern economics. What is market design mostly about? It's about agents are either too stupid or too ignorant or whatever to produce a truly good outcome. So what we do is we jigger around with the market to improve the outcome. But again, you see, what's the point? The point is what you think doesn't matter. The way I try to joke about this, and you won't get it, right? Move over Althusser, move over Foucault, move over Heidegger. This is what economists believe. Okay? Oh, come on. Sorry. Okay. Now, if you weren't upset about that, you know, just hang on for a minute. I now want to ask as a historian, where do truly new departures in economics come from? Well, I've already hinted at that. Where did neoclassicism come from? Was it the economists? A truly new departure in thinking about the economy has to be a cultural-wide change. And see, this is very important for people who are interested in pluralism to think about, okay? Where is the culture moving that would change the image of what markets are and what they do? Back in the 1870s, it was this energetic stuff, and that made neoclassicism believable. Which is an interesting question. Why would anybody believe it? You have to understand, it was a local European cultural thing. How about today? What are the conditions of a discipline that would look modern and scientific today? First, all the 20th century, late 20th century sciences are infatuated with computation, information, and complexity. Tell me I'm wrong. These are the cutting edge areas of the modern sciences, okay? See how I need a little bit of time if we were to go into this, but this is the history of the sciences now. This is what they look like in our lifetime. Also, of course, the important role of evolution. I'm going to come back to that. Evolution plays an important role, not just in biology, but in the vision of many across the sciences, okay? I've already mentioned this cultural movement towards anti-humanism, which I think is actually much more pervasive than just in economics. And then there's the neoliberal heritage. There's a political drift as well. There's a drift towards the idea that if markets are information processors, they aren't static allocators anymore, right? You see, because that's not quite the same thing. It isn't just getting people what they want when they don't happen to have it. It is instead telling people what they need to know. That's the way the culture thinks about markets, increasingly in your lifetime. Okay. Now, there's one more thing going on that I want to play with. I want to suggest, and by this sounds a little quasi-Marxist, I apologize, that the seeds of a new conception are always present in a sort of a corrupted way in the previous conception of markets. Okay, there's never a clean break with the past. See, this is the historian talking. There's never going to be something that's so new that no one ever thought of it, no one could understand. See, it's not going to be like that. What it's going to be is part of it is going to start in the orthodoxy, but it's not going to fit the orthodoxy very well. And what is that part that I'm going to highlight today? Okay, part that I'm going to highlight today is that if you look in the experimental economics literature, you look in market design theory, look in finance,
What do you see? Every once in a while, there's a subset of each of those groups that notices that market microstructures are actually different. Different markets are structured in different ways. And moreover, that seems to make a difference to the output. Shall I say that again? See, because that's the seed of the new and the old. They're noticing. See, let me put it this way. How does Walras think about markets?
They all operate the same.
They have to, because it's general equilibrium, right? How else would it work? What people are noticing in our time is that, wait a minute, no, there's different kinds of markets. They're structured different ways. Okay? Now, of course, being orthodox, what do they have to do? They have to somehow reconcile that with their basic commitment to neoclassicism, which is what? All markets ultimately operate the same way. And I could demonstrate this any number of times, and I do in the new book, okay? So they're trying to live a straddle. On the one hand, neoclassicism is true. On the other hand, markets operate in different ways. They would like both to be true at the same time. Here's what I'm suggesting to you. A modern, different economics would deny that. That there's no such thing as all markets operating the same way. That's the beginning of a truly different, a truly pluralist economics. I'm sorry, this is getting boring, isn't it? Look, I'm on the arrow, I'm clicking the thing. Should I just do the up and side arrow instead or something? What should I do?
Okay.
What's a better way to do this?
This arrow.
That'll do it? Okay, good. I'll just do that. Right, great, that's better. Okay. Okay. Now, again, the problem with me getting you to entertain this is that you're thinking, oh, who is this guy? I've never heard of him. What a wacko. Go on. Actually, in history, this observation has been made by very many important people. I'll give you some examples. Douglas North. It is a peculiar fact that the literature of economics contains so little discussion of the central institution that underlies neoclassical economics, the market! See, here's what I want you to begin to entertain, and I know it's just going to blow your education. Forget your education for a moment. Neoclassical economics is not about markets. It's about agents. Not the same thing. At all. Now, once you start thinking that way, see, this is the danger. Once you start thinking that way, you then start going down a path. What should I really think about? Should I think about the diversity of markets or the diversity of people? Because my humanist tendency is always to do what? Oh, people are different and we have to take all that. No. What if I should pay attention to the diversity of markets instead as the first principle of microeconomics? And by the way, this is... You can tell Alan Kerman is a buddy. I would be inclined to follow Murawski 2007 and suggest that what we are faced with is a multitude of coexisting institutions that we may care to call markets, but there is no standard market, unquote. Don't you see? That's what I'm suggesting. And Alan thinks maybe that's true, too. All right. Now, if you want to read about this some more, this is not in the books. I apologize that were mentioned. This is in a couple articles, one in Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization by me in 2007, another one, Journal of Institutionalist Economics in 2010. There's a little bit of it in Machine Dreams, but not very much. Okay. Now, I want to take a little time out and say, look, in a little bit of time that's remaining, I'm going to describe what an alternative economics like this looks like. But I want you to hold your breath. It's because you'll feel like you're in a science fiction movie, maybe The Matrix, the red pill versus the blue pill. Everything is going to look different. And that's how you know it's an alternative. Because everything will look different. Okay? But I also want to suggest, now see, this is the historian in me. I didn't come up with this. Hints of this tradition exist in the long history of writing about political economy. But I'll bet there are people you never heard of. Let me just try this out. How many people heard of William Thomas Thornton? No, I didn't expect. On Labor, a cosmic book. I use that term concertedly. 1869. Okay? Or John R. Commons. Yeah, I know, I'm in Germany, right? Commons, one of the less studied of the institutionalists, but actually kind of fascinating in his own right. Now, I imagine you heard of this guy, John von Neumann. No. See, if you heard of him, you probably thought, oh, well, he invented game theory. Yeah, but he didn't believe in it. See, this is the historian in me. He actually decided it wasn't that interesting, particularly after people got all worked up about Nash equilibrium. I write about that in Machine Dreams. What did he think a future economics would look like towards the end of his life? Well, a little bit like what I'm going to describe to you. But of course, you know, he was too busy, like, you know, helping design the atomic bomb and inventing the computer and shit like that, that he really didn't have time to do this too. All right? Okay, here's the story. Let's call this alternative microeconomics a general theory of market automata. Automata is a technical term from computer science. You may or may not have heard of it, okay? It's a subset of certain types of computers that obey certain regularities. Don't worry, I'm not going to do them so much in here. Okay. Here's what I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine microeconomics is about markets, each of which are characterized as automata. I'm going to come back to this in a minute, because some people actually are in groups like yours because they hate mathematics. I'm not one of them. I think we need a different mathematics. Not that the mathematics is wrong, okay? Not mathematics in general, okay? So basically what I'm suggesting is that many of these ideas are going to come from computer science. And by the way, isn't that what's just happening in the other natural sciences in your lifetime? See, that's my point. That's how it would happen, just like it did in the 19th century, right? Now, here's the science fiction-y part. Not only are there a bunch of different markets that are characterized by these automata, but they evolve. They evolve in an environment. And what is the environment? Hold on to your hat. The environment is us. The environment is people. Instead of treating people like the subject, let's treat people like the environment in which the subject evolves. You see how this is an entire reversal. This is something that no orthodox economist could entertain. Let me say it again, because this is the hard part, actually. Think of markets as little machines, although abstract machines, that evolve, that are different, and the environment in which they involve are people. And people are wonderfully diverse, and we do not have a theory of people. Just like in biology, maybe ecology is a little different, in biology, you do not have a theory of the environment. You have a theory of the thing that evolves. What does replication look like in this different world? Replication is not physical, it's computational, because the entities are computational. All right? There's no single generic of index of success that governs all automata, just like there is no single index of success that governs all organisms. So this isn't yet another simple-minded maximization story, which is always the tendency, right? You always want to get back to that maximization. See, that's the error. Selection, what is the who selects? We do. We select. We use some types of markets more. We neglect others. The ones that we use get replicated. They become more common. You see? It's a serious evolutionary story. And what is mutation? This is just simplifying now. What is mutation? Well, it's people bending or not obeying the rules of the markets. How do markets change? People cheat. They alter. But notice, they don't do it too much, because too much mutation would do what? Destroy the system. If you know anything about biology, you know that that's a kind of a theorem. Too much mutation would destroy the system. So there's only a limited amount of this kind of change that's allowed. Okay, have you taken the red pill yet? Now, a lot of you possibly, I mean, I don't mean to impugn you, if none of you are guilty of this, then ignore me right now. A lot of you don't like the math. And your reaction is to say, no, we should have a microeconomics without the math. No! That's why pluralism dies. Shall I say that again? That's why pluralism dies. There's a formal aspect to markets, and this theory should acknowledge that formal aspect. Although it's very interesting, it will be about computational mathematics, and that in and of itself makes certain statements about the nature of trade, which may shock you. So, for example, here's what I want to argue, and I'm willing to, you know, if we got time later, we can talk about this in greater detail. Neoclassical economics is wrong for a bunch of reasons, but one reason is it uses the wrong math. It uses the math of 19th century physics. It uses the calculus. It uses real analysis. It is defined over the domain of the Euclidean space of the reals. No one trades in that space. Let me put it this way. Have you ever bought the square root of 2 of anything? Or I? See? This is why Gerard de Brouwer is wrong. Economics is not a mathematical science because trade happens on the reals, because it doesn't. It doesn't. What does trade, and by the way, this is for those of you who are tech heads. Also, presuming Euclidean space presumes that trade is reversible and isotropic in commodity space. In other words, anything that I purchase, I could eventually work myself back to, by trade, to the same amount at the same price. No one can do that. No one! The math of neoclassical economics is empirically wrong. What kind of math describes trade? Computable mathematics over rational numbers. All money is in terms of rational numbers, and all trade is in terms of ratios. See? So already, we said, no, not your math, this math. Mathematics is treated as a metaphor in neoclassical economics. It's not literal. Trade is not like motion through space. Let's make a literal mathematics, the mathematics that's actually used in the markets. You thought I was just going to sneer at mathematics, didn't you? By the way, this is really quick. This is what an automaton looks like that I'm talking about. See? And by the way, this is the way you would study it in a computer science text, too. Okay? Here, I've portrayed a simple auction as an automaton. Okay? What happens is that the seller starts off there at the top, makes an offer to sell. Okay? The offer is conveyed to other participants. The other buyers bid or not. And then what happens is that according to some rule, the best bid is arrived at, possibly accepted, and I'm not presuming that's true, or else the whole situation is refused, bang, back to the start. You see, now you're beginning to see what I mean by automata. This is the way we should describe trade. It is not motion in space. All right, if you haven't bit down on the pill yet, let's go a little bit farther. Okay. What do we talk about when we talk about markets? And by the way, now I am not talking about your textbook, because your textbook probably doesn't cover any of this. But let's say that you're somebody who really cares about markets, like, you know, cares about financial markets. What do you have to talk about? Got to talk about data dissemination and exclusion, who hears what's going on, who does not, under what circumstances, order routing through space and time. You have to know how orders get transferred, who gets to order, who gets to execute the order, and under what conditions. Price discovery and assignment, and then, you know, I can hear all the orthodox people getting excited for the first time, because that's what all their theory is about. It's about one tiny subset of what goes on. Just the price discovery, nothing else. All right. Custody and delivery arrangements. See, I mean, for some of you, this is just boring. Ooh, you know, this is like stuff you learn in business school or something. Yeah. This is how the world works. The legal is intimately intertwined with the formal, always. Always. Okay. Record keeping, which again sounds boring, but actually turns out to be very important. Who keeps the records? Where's the order book? Who controls the order book? Commodity definition and enforcement, again, that sounds boring. That's absolutely central. How do we know what the commodity is, what counts as the commodity? Again, the legal and the measurement, the formal, are intertwined directly. Now, this all seems incredibly, possibly complicated. How could this be important? I'm giving another talk in Hanover in a couple, I don't know, a week or something. I'm going to argue that the crisis is a result of change in bankruptcy rules. And you see, it comes directly from this tradition. That the crisis isn't just mortgage market or something like that. See, because what went wrong isn't intimately connected to mortgages. What went wrong is an interesting combination of the rules of bankruptcy and the rules of collateral being twisted in the interests of certain people's presumptions. And that's how the crisis was precipitated. You see, only from this microeconomic point of view can I even think that that's important. Modern Orthodox economists don't even pay attention to that stuff. How boring. All right, I'm just going to suggest to you again that other people have made these arguments implicitly before. And how many of you people ever heard of Godin Sunder's zero intelligence agents? See? How can you be plural if you don't know what's out there? This is a wonderful set of articles. The first one in 1993 Journal of Political Economy, second one in 1997 Quarterly Journal of Economics, where they had this brilliant idea. I don't know if you know this, but Vernon Smith, who by the way is a neoliberal, a member of the Mont Pelerin Society, if you didn't know that, has argued that markets always work and that his experiments showed that that was true, that markets under a certain set of conditions always converge to equilibrium. And so for him, as a Mont Pelerin guy, that just shows that doesn't matter, people can be stupid, whatever, markets always work. You see, that would be the neoliberal interpretation. These guys are brilliant. They decided to ask, well, why does that result happen? And so what they did was they ran Vernon's experiments with, you know, kids, undergraduates, and then with robots. Robots who can't think and who bid and ask blindly. That's why they're called zero intelligence agents, you see? They're agents who are dumb. All they do is bid and ask. And what's interesting about the paper is both what they found and then the interpretation. What did they find? Convergence to equilibrium happens essentially the same with humans and robots. Hardly any difference. Now, let's engage ourselves from it. Let's try to interpret that. What's the right way to interpret that finding? And by the way, they were given a lot of grief at the JPE, which remember is the University of Chicago Journal. They interpreted the finding as basically saying that whatever experimental evidence we find for convergence to equilibrium is not due to the people involved. You see what I mean by anti-humanism? It's not due to the people. It's just due to the structural rules of the market itself. In other words, they are thinking about markets as automata who produce their results on their own. And it doesn't matter how smart or stupid or what your utility is or anything. The regularities come from the structure, not from the agency. See, I'm not the only one to argue this. I don't have time, but let's just ignore it. The second paper is even more interesting. I would suggest that you look at it. What they do is they start breaking down the market into its subcomponents, trying to decide, well, which part is responsible for this convergence, which is you take the machine apart. And you say, well, which parts of the machine are really the most important for producing this result? That's what you would do if you look at the world this way. All right, I'm going to apologize now. Here's what you would learn in my alternate universe for micro. You would learn that there was a general way of thinking about markets. They should all be modeled as finite automata. They're defined over an alphabet and states of the world. This is common computer science, so I didn't make any of this up, okay? There's a transition function, script T, that maps you into the current state of the world and inputs into another state of the world. Some subsets of the states of the world are accepting states. So you see, there's not an equilibrium. Markets just halt. They don't achieve equilibrium. They just halt sometimes. They arrive at an acceptable outcome, and they halt. They could also be non-deterministic. I don't need to go into this, but what's beautiful about this is we're building in a kind of a randomness at the very core of microeconomics, not deterministic, like Walrasian theory, all right? And it's easy to see how this works with the price determination function, but what I want to suggest is all those other functions of the market that I mentioned, they can all be modeled this way. All the functions of the market can be modeled as automata. So really, a market is just a bunch of automata put together, kind of like Lego blocks. Mix and match. But of course, isn't that how evolution would work? Why should we think of the world this way? Because I know you need convincing, right? The blue pill is not enough. Why would you want to think of the world this way? Okay. First, it stresses that any economy is an ecology of various populations of market forms evolving through time. There is no rest point. All this rest point equilibrium crap's got to go. A market is always moving. All right. It allows application of formal complexity measures, and I see I'm running out of time. I want you to see how serious I am about this. I've got another 10 slides on complexity measures. See, you can actually do stuff with this, too. All right. You would also use network theory applied to the linked market forms. So it's not enough that there are these individual market automata, but of course we use network theory to show that they tend to deal with one another more than others. And of course that would be a network story. Okay. What is failure? See, I think one of the more interesting euphemisms of neoclassical economics is market failure, right? Like, I've heard Joe Stiglitz, oh, what happened in 07, 08 is market failure. What is market failure in neoclassical theory? Oh, I didn't make it to Pareto optimum. But you see, if we're really as anti-humanist as I'm suggesting, who cares? Plus, is that what really happened in 07, 08? We just didn't make it to Pareto optimum? See, it's a misuse of the term failure. It is. It's a disgrace on the term failure, don't you think? It's not what failure means. It's not what people mean when they say the market's failed. What does failure mean here in this way of looking at the world? Failure means an inability to halt. And isn't that what people meant when they saw markets, the prices free-falling in certain equity markets? See, the market wouldn't give us a real price. It wouldn't give us a dependable price. That's precisely what this says, that true market failure is an inability of these individual automata to halt. By the way, you know what that's like. You know how when you get in some kind of stupid do loop something in your laptop and you have to, it crashes? That's what we're talking about. That's what market failure looks like. Okay, let me do just one more thing so you know how serious I am about this. You see, economics should be both a serious subject and a formal subject. It should want to describe the world, but it also should be formal, but formal in the sense that it uses the mathematics that the participants use to describe what is going on. And so I just want to give you a very quick example from complexity. Remember I told you that complexity is also one of the big themes of modern science. Complexity would be central to this kind of microeconomics. And complexity doesn't mean, oh, it's hard, or it's, it's just too complicated, I can't grasp it, or something. No. Complexity has two formal meanings. One, the Chomsky language hierarchy. See, you really have to learn some computer science. That's what I'm talking about. That there's a hierarchy of powers of computers. Some computers are very low power. Other computers, progressively higher power. And there's a theory of how one decides this, which I can't do here, but still, that you know that. So we are talking about a hierarchy of markets. Some markets are extremely simple and can't do very much. Other markets are far more complicated, and they can do more. And some of the more that they can do is they can imitate or simulate the operation of simpler markets. This is a one-way relationship. Simple markets cannot emulate the operation of more complex markets, but more complex markets can emulate the operation of simpler markets. What am I talking about? A futures market is more complicated than a spot market. A futures market simulates the operation of the spot market, but does more. That's just one example. There would be many examples, okay? So that's one kind of complexity. And you see, we begin to characterize the mix of markets by the complexity of the ensemble of markets. And however many are, and let me get this out of the way because I don't know how much farther I can go. Now here we go back to biology. What do you think, in terms of biomass, is the most complicated organism in the world? Come on. Us? Wonderful us? No, we are far too complicated. It's bacteria, if we go for invertebrates. And if we go for, they're not vertebrates, they're the in-between. Sorry, why am I blanking on this? It's beetles. In terms of biomass, beetles are far more prevalent than we are. Now, why am I saying this? Because it's well understood regularity that in most ecologies, the simpler organisms are the most prevalent. At least in terms of biomass. So when we take this over to this way of thinking, what am I saying? The simplest forms of markets are the most prevalent. Now, what do I mean by simple forms? I actually have done this in a couple of different places. I have shown that specific types of automata map mathematically into specific types of markets. So the simplest kind of automata, which is a finite regular automata, maps into a posted price market. You guys know what I mean by posted price market? This is actually standard terminology in experimental. Does anyone know what I mean? Posted price? Come on, what do you get at the supermarket? I go in the supermarket, there's a price. I either accept it or I don't. Duh. That's it. That is a posted price market. A posted price market is the simplest kind of market there is. A pushdown automaton is the same as a sealed bid auction. You guys know what a sealed bid auction is? Everyone hands in bids, but no one knows the other people's bids. Some auctioneer, reads them all, decides which one is the appropriate one, usually the highest, and awards, okay? That's the next simplest. Another one, even more simpler market, is the double auction market. Anyone know what double auction is? You really need to know this, because double auction is the workhorse of experimental economics. That's what most experimental economics is done on. It's much more complicated. Why is it a double auction? Because notice, one side of the market, participants can bid, the other side can ask, and everyone is freely able to see what the other side is doing and who's doing it. Do you see why it's more complicated? Because there's more computation going on. Now, why do I bring this up? What's the kind of market that those of you in business school going into finance study? Oh, come on, guys. Most of those finance markets are double auction. But finance is unusual because it's the locus of some of the most complicated types of markets. Whereas in everyday life, what do you encounter? Much more frequently. Fixed price. You see, the analogy is direct. In evolution, the simplest organisms dominate. But think about it. If you get weird mixtures of highly complicated and simple markets, the system could move closer and closer to an instability. See, an entirely different way of thinking about macro. Nothing like Keynes. See, I honestly think you can't go home again. We can't go back to Marx, it's over. We certainly cannot go back to Ricardo. And I hate to offend you, we can't go back to Keynes. We have to rethink the whole thing from ground up. And that's how you know, I'm gonna stop here because I'm running out of time. That's how you know you got pluralism. Because there's no way a neoclassical economist can say, oh, we've got a model that does that. No. The world has to look so different that they couldn't possibly map their stories onto this. You see? The math's not right. Agency isn't there. It's evolutionary in a serious sense. It's about real evolution, not fake evolution like Nelson Winner or something like that. That's what pluralism looks like. All right, I'm going to stop there. I've got some other stuff, but I thought we should talk, you know, instead, because that might be more.